Yes, yes.
We can start including people.
With the blessings of Shri Shyam Narayan Zagdu Singh Thakur and Shri Ram Narayan Zagdu Singh Thakur, Thakur College of Engineering and Technology was established in year 2001 under the able management and leadership of our beloved chairman, Mr. V.K. Singh. TCET has become one of the fastest growing institutes in India, starting with an intake of 180 seats in year 2001 and now having one of the highest intakes of 950 plus seats in the city of Bombay. The institute has come far ahead. It has 6 UGBE courses, 3 newly added UG courses in BTech program, 3 PG courses and 3 PhD courses. TCET has been a testament of growth, prosperity and excellence in quality education. With the vision of becoming internationally renowned institute of engineering and technology, TCET has always taken steps in this direction to make it a reality. Institute is approved by AICT, certified by ISO and recognized by UGC under 2F and 12B. It has a NAC approval with A grade and has completed 3 cycles of NBA accreditation. TCET attained autonomy status for a decade with effect from academic year 2019, and since then it has come even closer to its vision. The college has been securing positions in NIRF ranking by the government in top 10% colleges of the country for 2 years now. It has also been coming in top 100 colleges in Outlook rankings for the past 2 years and has also won Asia Pacific Award. But what makes TCET truly stand out is actually its dedication and hard work to provide holistic education, which is true to its meaning. TCET not just imparts education to get an engineering degree, but gives experiences and exposures that teach you to excel in life as whole. College always tries its best to provide students multiple platforms where they can develop their skills, right from writing research papers for Multicon to showcasing their hidden talents and celebrating themselves in Sojourn, practically implementing things at in-house internships, demonstrating their sportsmanship in events like T-Spark and Inertia, to lifelong memorable educational excursions. TCET aims at a 360-degree development of student. We have 7 professional bodies, 3 social bodies, 2 clubs, and a student council that are not just working committees, but a well-knitted family. TCET is a supportive community that builds together, grows together, and is never afraid of challenges. It takes every day as a day of improvement to achieve perfection. Even in the current pandemic situation, TCET changed it into an opportunity to give a top-notch virtual teaching learning experience, from practical exams to online internships to Gusto and Technofest to webinar series and to celebrating days like Yoga and Foundation Day. College provided the perfect edutainment platform to keep the students and faculties engaged. We all strived hard, learnt new things, improved ourselves daily, and most importantly, stood by each other to support and together build a better today and a tomorrow. That's why we can proudly say TCET is not just an institution. It is a family where you are nurtured, loved, and cared. With heads held high, we all can say that we are a proud TCETian.
On the behalf of management and Thakur College of Engineering and Technology, I take an opportunity to express my sincere thanks to all the stakeholders who have supported the institute directly or indirectly in the journey of 19 years. My special thanks to the students, faculty, parents, and the industry who have supported the growth of the institute. We started the journey as an affiliated institute of University of Mumbai in the academic year 2001-02. And today, in the current academic year, we got the autonomous status. We hope if the support continues from the stakeholders, soon we'll become the deemed university and the Institute of Eminence. Thank you once again to all the stakeholders.
A very good morning to one and all, respected principals, vice principals, deans, heads of departments, academia professionals, honorable speaker, faculty members, my fellow students, and all our viewers on Zoom. On behalf of the management, principal, vice principal, deans, faculty, and the staff of Thakur College of Engineering and Technology, I, Ayushi Sarda, welcome you all to TCET's Outreach and Extension Initiative. It is often said that the illiterates of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but rather those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. The most frequent word one hears today in all education is STEM. STEM is an approach to learning and development that integrates the areas of science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Through STEM, students develop key skills, including problem solving, creativity, critical analysis, and teamwork. A solid foundation in mathematics and science develops the skills of seeking evidence, solving problems, while being open to new information. I am pleased to announce that today's session, Calculus for Data Science, will be taken by Dr. Neeta Jain, Assistant Professor and Activity Head of Student Mentor and Grievances, TCET. I now call upon Mr. Utkarsh Sharma to introduce our speaker.
Thank you, Ayushi. Good morning to everyone present here. I am Utkarsh Sharma, a computer science engineering student from Thakur College of Engineering and Technology, and I am here to introduce the speaker of day two of online workshop of data science and mathematics. Today's session will be focused on calculus for data science, conducted by our speaker, Dr. Neeta Jain, Assistant Professor, Engineering Science and Humanity Department, and Activity Head of Student Mentoring and Grievances. She is qualified PhD in Mathematics from Department of Mathematics, Veer Narmad, South Gujarat University. She also holds the specialization in Applied Mathematics. She is well experienced in teaching with 24 years of experience. She has also worked as FE in charge, Deputy FE in charge, NSS Program Officer, WDC in charge. She has also achievements like co-author of Applied Mathematics 1 and Applied Mathematics 2 textbooks strictly as per CBCGS, that is Choice-Based Credit and Grading System. She has also presented and published 6 international as well as national conference and 6 international journals. Also, she has received minor research grant from Mumbai University. So, over to you, Ayushi.
Thank you, Utkarsh. Without any further ado, I would like to hand over the session to Neeta ma'am. I'm sure we're all eager to learn what you have to say. Over to you, ma'am.
Am I audible, Ayushi?
Yes, ma'am. Your voice is breaking a little, though. Yeah, now it's better.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Ayushi and Utkarsh, for the warm welcome and a lovely introduction. I hope you all must be fine and enjoying the learning through this workshop. Before we proceed to the next session or today's session, we would like to have a quick recap of whatever we have learned during basics of linear algebra. And this recap we would like to take in the form of quiz. So let me share the screen and let me take you to the path from where we are going to take up a quiz. So 1 minute. Is the screen visible? Is the screen
yes,
visible?
Ma'am. Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay. So I request all the participants to take up the quiz. Please open up www.menti.com. You have to log in to other browser and then you have to log in to www.menti.com. Once you open this browser, this type of window will get pop up. Can we unmute one or two participants and can we ask them whether they are able to do it or not? Is it possible? Ayushi, are you there?
Ma'am, we have already asked 4 to 5 participants to unmute.
Fine. Okay.
Let's see if they unmute.
Okay. Because if I hope all the participants must be able to log into or maybe open to this particular browser.
Yes, ma'am.
If anyone is unmute, can you answer me, please?
Or they can write in chat also.
Yeah. We can share the link in the chat box.
Yeah, participants, please respond in chat whether you are able to log in menti.com. Yeah, we are receiving the responses.
Okay.
Thank you.
So they are able to do?
Yeah, they're able. Now you can proceed further for the further instruction.
It's a request to all the participants. Once you open up this browser, then kindly enter this code. There must be a request for entering the code. So the code for day is 792207. 792207. Once you enter the code, please click on to submit. And then wait for next instruction. If any difficulty, please interact through the chat box. And if you are able to do, it's a request to participant, then please interact through the chat box. So we come to know whether all are able to enter the code and submit the code so that we can float the questions.
Yeah, it is a dedicative code for this particular quiz only, and it is not yet active. Okay, so just wait for the
wait for some time. Once you submit the code, then you have to keep on waiting till the question will be released from the authority and question will pop up on your screen. So I hope now everyone must be settled with this. So can we start with questions? Yogesh sir?
Yes, madam.
Can we start with the questions?
Yes, madam. You please stop sharing. I will start.
Okay.
Yeah, quiz is not open. Yeah, I could see 19 participants have joined the quiz. 19 participants have joined the quiz. Now, let me open the quiz. I hope the screen is visible to everyone. Is the screen visible to everyone?
Code is available here. Someone is asking for a code. Please check the code from here.
Is the screen is visible to everyone? Yeah. So let me start the quiz. Here we go for the first question. Still participants are entering.
Okay. You have been provided code to enter into menti.com.
Seven participants have entered. Okay, now here we go for the first question. The first question is visible on the screen. The time limit to answer this question is 40 seconds. Please, all participants are requested to please answer within 40 seconds. The last 20 seconds are remaining. Last 10 seconds. Now just wait for the further question. Time up. So the correct answer was eigenvector. 15 have answered correctly. 11 participants have answered wrong way. 15 have answered correctly. Now we'll go for the next question. Here is the second question on the screen. The time starts now. Again, the time limit for this is 40 seconds. Last 15 seconds are remaining. Yes, time up. 35 have given the answer. Now the correct answer is data frame. 14 participants have given the correct answer. Now here we go for the next question. The next question is visible on the screen. Again, the time limit is 40 seconds. Time starts now. Last 20 seconds. Time up. 37 have responded, and the correct answer is set WD. 21 have answered correctly. 21 participants have answered correctly. Now we go for the next last question of the quiz. Here we get the next question on the screen. The time limit is again 40 seconds. Now last 20 seconds are remaining. Time up. 37 have responded, and almost 31 participants have answered correctly this question. So thank you very much for participating in this Mentimeter quiz. Now, over to you, Neeta madam.
Okay.
We have done with the quiz.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, participants, for taking the quiz and gearing up towards the end of the quiz. I'll just take 1 minute to share the screen and to start with my presentation, to start with today's session. I think now screen is visible to everyone. Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So coming to today's session, today we are meeting for second session of this workshop, Mathematics and Data Science. Today together, we will be exploring calculus for data science. The outline of today's presentation is introduction, multivariate calculus, gradient descent algorithm, singular value decomposition. Now, question arising in my mind is, why mathematics is needed for data science? What is the use of it? Because once I hear data science, it comes just in my mind, it's a collection of data, probably analyzing the data and then presenting the result based on this analysis. So I fail to understand where the mathematics is applied here. Of course, mathematics in the data science and machine learning is not about crunching numbers, but about what is happening, why it's happening, and how we can play around the different things to obtain the results we want. Data science offers different roles in the field, and each role has different requirements for the mathematics perspective. So if you are someone who is inclined towards the engineering side of data, then definitely you don't need much of the mathematics. But for someone who wants to master the machine learning and deep learning, they must be familiar with the mathematics concepts like linear algebra, vector calculus, probability theory, because as a data scientist, one should not require to know only machine learning algorithm, but also to leverage one's knowledge, build more efficient models, and comprehend and debug existing algorithmic approaches. If you are aspiring as a data scientist, you should not only knowing scikit-learn or TensorFlow, but you are required to know how a decision tree calculates the Gini impurity at each node, how a cost function of a linear regression model is optimized, or what is a decision function for a linear SVM classification. Now coming to the calculus part, again, the question is, what is the role of calculus in the data science? Because all the topics of mathematics we are not needing for the data science. A particular topic may be more important in data science. The other topic might have a less significance. So we are not discussing those topics at this moment. So today we are going to discuss few concepts and application of multivariate calculus. Most of the real world prediction or analysis problem have multiple variables to see how different variables play different roles in predicting the output. Multivariable calculus is used. The deeper understanding of calculus can set you apart from peers who just plug and chug data into the algorithm. The calculus is the branch of a mathematics which deals with the rate of change of quantities, which we also as a mathematically say slope. The calculus, as we all are knowing, is divided into two parts, differential calculus and integral calculus. When it comes to differential calculus, it cuts something into small pieces to find how it changes. When it comes to integral calculus, it joins the small pieces together to find how much there is. So data scientists use calculus for almost every model. A basic but a very excellent example of the calculus is gradient descent algorithm, which the data scientists are using. Yes, when I am talking about the differentiation, smile comes on everyone's face. As we all are aware, very much aware of this particular term, differentiation, where we differentiate dependent variable with respect to the independent variable. Now, when I consider the dependency, we know, as we have learned in the school algebra, or maybe during your 10 plus 2 classes, this dependency of a function may have on a one variable or one parameter, or it may have on more than one variable or more parameters. So if I differentiate dependency with respect to one variable, we call it as an ordinary derivative and we denote it by D. But if the dependency is on multivariate, then we name it as a partial derivative and we denote it by del. Either we pronounce it as del or daba, depending upon how you are comfortable with that. So today we are going to more focused on this multivariate differentiation. But again, why I need to talk much about this multivariate differentiation? Because in real world problem, as we said earlier, multiple dependency we are coming across. Because if I have to study some particular model, it will depend on certain parameters. And as we are looking for some particular modeling to solve through the mathematics, this partial differentiation will be at my helm. But in data science, when we calculate partial derivative with respect to one parameter, we treat all rest of the weights or biases as constant. From the partial derivative, we are trying to find out what is a change in a cost function if change a particular weight. Now, when I'm hearing this word, maybe some of you are familiar with the data science terminology, but some of you might not be familiar with this terminology. So I have used the word weight, bias, cost function. This is all we are going to see how it is defined in data science in later on talk, or maybe today's talk. But right now, what is the role of partial differentiation in data science? That is what I'm trying to talk to you. So for this, one must be familiar with how much that specific variable or parameter is contributing to the final loss. Again, this loss word is not known to us, but we'll come to that part as well. And this gives us what is the responsibility of that particular parameter in the final model error. Okay, discussing much about this partial differentiation, what I am knowing is, if I talk mathematically, probably if my function depends upon two variable x and y, and if I have to find the rate of a function with respect to x or a change in the direction of x, we try to find out the derivative as del f by del x. So when I'm talking about del f by del x, I understand that my function f is a scalar and I differentiate it with respect to a scalar. So now scalar differentiation with respect to the scalar I am knowing, but I want to check if instead of scalar I have given a vector, then what will be a derivative of vector with respect to the scalar? Because when we are coming to data science, my data is not, or data is always represented in terms of arrays, or this arrays we can consider as a vector form, and then from that perspective we would like to understand how the differentiation of vector with respect to scalar can be found. So if I consider A as my vector component vector and x as a scalar, then derivative of this A with respect to x is defined as del ai upon del x. Note that when we differentiate vector with respect to a scalar, the resultant is also going to be a vector. to understand this, I have considered a two-tuple vector. So let's consider A as a two-tuple vector whose components is A1 and A2. And when I differentiate this vector A with respect to a scalar x, I will get the rate of change of first component with respect to x and rate of change of second component with respect to x. So my final answer is going to be a vector. Now change the situation a little bit. Okay. If instead of two components, I take the three components. And instead of taking the general element of a component or general element of the vector, I just try to take some known function so that we understand if I continue with the derivative, whatever the rules we know about the derivative, tools we know about the derivative, the similar rules and tools we need to apply. So when I differentiate my first component of this triplet, then x square derivative with respect to x is nothing, but it will come to x. Likewise, the second and third component also we can differentiate and we get the derivative of triplet vector or three tuple vector with respect to a scalar. Now I am changing the situation a little bit. I am differentiating scalar with respect to a vector. If I flip A and x, then I would like to understand how the derivative is going to be. So that comes to my next part, where now I consider A as a scalar and I try to see if this scalar I'm going to differentiate with respect to a vector, what will be a resultant? Again, the resultant is going to be a vector, and this vector mathematically we are knowing as a gradient. Possibly again try to take one simple example and try to visualize how this result we are going to obtain. So for simplicity, again I have taken getting some problem. Yeah, again I have taken two tuple vector. X is a vector, so x considered as a two tuple vector whose components are x1 and x2. And when I differentiate scalar with respect to x, then that scalar rate of change I am getting in x1 direction as well as in x2 direction. Because I am talking here in terms of direction, as vector always represented by a direction. So instead of saying what will be the derivative, we say I get the rate of change of scalar in the x1 direction and I get the rate of change of scalar in x2 direction. Of course, this is again going to be a vector form and the transpose indicates this is not going to be a row vector, but it's going to be a column vector. Same thing, I just try to understand in terms of three tuple vectors. So three tuple vectors, again, I have taken a particular value for my scalar and scalar is taken as a function of x1, x2, x3. And based on this relation, when I find out the derivative of this scalar with respect to the vector, I'm getting my rate of change of A with respect to x1, x2, and x3. Or I may say in the direction of x1, x2, and x3. And this is going to be again my vector. Now see, three situations we analyze: scalar with respect to x, scalar, vector with respect to scalar, and scalar with respect to vector. So the fourth combination still exists. When I'm talking about the fourth combination, I mean to say, now I have a possibility of getting the vector with respect to vector. So I am proceeding for the differentiation of vector with respect to vector. And this is really going to be interesting for us. And this is what basically we needed when we are talking about any algorithm minimizing the error, or probably when we would like to predict anything in data science with the help of mathematics. Probably where rate of change is needed, we need this particular differentiation. Now, if I consider A as a vector and X also as a vector, the fourth combination I'm talking about, then my resultant is again going to be a vector. But to your surprise, this vector is going to depend on the dimension of the vector A as well as the vector X. If A dimension of X is okay, let me take example and then we'll get more clarity. Am I audible?
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
okay.
Madam.
Okay, thank you. Because I need little clearance so that I at least understand whether I'm going correctly or not, or whether I'm finding the things properly or not. Okay. So when we are talking about a vector differentiation with respect to a vector, so for simplicity, again, I have taken a two-tuple vector, both A and X. So now when I'm talking about this differentiation, look at here, the first component of A is differentiable with respect to both X1 and X2, because then it will give me the rate of change in X1 and X2 direction. And when I differentiate this first component with respect to X1 and X2, that will form my first row for the vector differentiation. Similarly, the second component of A, its rate of change also we need to observe in the direction of X1 and X2. And when I find that derivative, I will be getting my second row. One need to be very careful. It may happen, we may find out both the component change with respect to X1 direction, then this element is going to change. Probably then it will be del A2 by del X2, del X1. So which way you are forming this particular vector differentiation, one need to be a little particular. So I mean to say, there is a possibility A1 and A2 rate will be found with respect to X1 first, and then A1 and A2 rate will be found with respect to X2 as well. I was just talking about, depending upon A and X dimension, my resultant is becoming a matrix now. Of course, matrix can be thought of made up of vector. So again, I can conclude in this way, the vector differentiation with respect to vector is again going to be a vector, but dimension of this vector is going to increase. Dimension in the sense it is going to come in terms of matrix. And this we know as second order tensor. Why I am discussing all these things? Just imagine, instead of two tuple, if I will be considering a three tuple vector, then this matrix different or this vector differentiation is going to be much more larger. And if instead of this two and three component, if I take n component, because when we are analyzing a data, we might be analyzing a lots of inputs received for that particular analysis. So that way, I need a multi-dimensional differentiation of vector with respect to vector. Of course, manually when we try to do, it will be more time consuming. And for that, we need to look the help of software. What was the intention of talking about this vector differentiation I just cleared? But before I proceed to that next part of data science, gradient and descent algorithm, one more thing I would like to understand. Instead of a vector, now I want to differentiate transformed vector with respect to the original vector. What I mean by a transformed vector, we all know this matrix is representing a linear transformation. So I am applying a linear transformation on the vector X. I am getting a transformed vector. And then this transformed vector we are differentiating with respect to another vector X. Now you simply say, what is new in this? We already seen how vector will be differentiable with respect to vector, but this is not going to be similar to the previous one, because here first I need to find out what will be the transformed vector AX. Once I know this product, then only I will be able to differentiate it with respect to the another vector. So I mean to say, if we consider A as a 2 by 2 matrix or a 2 by 2 matrix along with this X as a 2 tuple, then first I need to find out my linear transformation result when I apply it to X, which is going to be AX. Everyone knows this matrix multiplication. I applied the row column method that gives me my product in this way. Now, this product can be identified as a vector. Did we learn in the previous slide how this vector can be differentiable with respect to another vector? So now when I go for this differentiation, what we have understood earlier, the same thing I'm applying here, and I'm differentiating first component of this particular linear or transformed vector with respect to x1 and x2. And then the second element, again, I am differentiating with respect to x1 and x2, or I am trying to get the rate of change of second component in the x1 and x2 direction. And we all are knowing how we need to evaluate this derivative. When I evaluate with respect to x1, my x2 will be treated constant. So my that answer is going to be a11. Likely, I continue with the rest of the derivative. And then to my surprise, I am getting the answer of this particular differentiation as A. Why I want to have this particular observation? Because when I'm coming to my this algebraic expression, we know what will be the derivative of an algebraic expression. Again, we say what is a great deal in that. So I just want to observe some pattern and I just want to think of, is that pattern is going to be followed if I multiply a vector by some higher order or maybe a matrices, then what will be the pattern? I want to say, if I differentiate kx with respect to x, I am getting the answer as k. If I take kx square with respect to x, that is 2kx. If I take kx cube with respect to x, it will be 3kx square. And if I continue further, you all will be able to tell me, you all will be able to predict, it is going to be, if I take kx power 4, it will become 4kx cube. So there is a, some kind of similarity, some pattern is followed. And based on this pattern, if we ask to guess any of the derivative of higher order, we will be able to guess it. So same thing, we just want to understand, or you may explore, you may experiment whether existing for matrix or not. So yes, it does exist for a matrix, but it exists in a different way. If I multiply x with a square and I differentiate, then I will be getting it here as answer a square. I leave this exercise to verify to the participants. If you have a time, you can just sit back and check whether some kind of analogy is there or not. Again, what I should do to observe this pattern, because when we are talking about the data science, we whatever data we collected, carefully we need to analyze that data. So when I am analyzing, or when one is analyzing a data, one has to understand what kind of relation the data is having, how they are related to each other. Because based on their correlation or based on their relationship between the data, we will be able to predict whatever is required as an output out of that model. So this kind of intuition we need to develop. And of course, math or mathematics will help us to think in this direction. If I take a cube x, then what will be its derivative with respect to x? Fine. So maybe you try to experiment it next session. If the time permits, definitely we would like to know what will be the answer for this kind of analogy. One more example. But how this example is differing from the earlier one? Because again, you may say, instead of ax, now I have taken x transpose ax. And we all know, who might have studied the applied mathematics, that is x transpose ax we name as a quadratic form. My ax was a vector, but this x transpose ax, when I consider, it becomes a scalar. And already I discussed this particular differentiation with you. When differentiating this kind of transformation, linear transformation, when I'm applying on x, what will be my derivative with respect to a variable? So first of all, if I relate with what we discussed earlier, I just would like to recall, this is nothing but going to be my gradient. So for simplicity, if we take up two tuple vector and 2x2 matrix A, So when I find this product, x transpose ax, it's going to be a scalar. And now when I differentiate the scalar with respect to a vector, it's again going to be a vector. And when I rearrange the vector, my answer comes in the form, I have not shown you all the calculation here. Calculation part I have If someone is interested, can verify it, but I have just directly written the answer. So X transpose AX, when I differentiate with respect to X, it turns out to be A plus A transpose X. So maybe with this transpose, some analogy we try to observe here. And this result is more important for me when it comes to the data science, because all the time we are going to deal with the symmetric matrix. So if I have given a symmetric matrix, this A transpose is going to be nothing but it is A. And then this result in case of symmetric matrix will become 2AX. So this result has a different significance in the data science application. So I thought I will just take it up here and we try to understand when we multiply a vector with a matrix, how different possibility arises. And all this possible differentiation we have discussed. Coming to my next part, and this is where the technical people must be interested, that is gradient descent algorithm. But before we talk about the gradient descent algorithm, some examples I would like to quote for defining the gradient descent. And then some real world problem we'll pick up and we'll try to see how it will be compared to gradient descent algorithm, how that model can be thought of and how its solution can be obtained. So talking to the gradient, or coming back to the gradient, gradient we all have understood. Am I audible? Because I'm getting some connection issue here.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, sir. Gradient, if you recall again, we have just said when scalar is differentiable, a rate of change of scalar is found with respect to a vector, I get the gradient. So mathematically, this gradient represents a partial derivative with respect to its independent variables. This gradient can be referred as a slope of a function. As gradient is going to be a vector, the direction of this gradient is going to be in the direction of maximum increase of a function. Please remember this. Gradient is a rate of change and its direction is going to be in the direction of maximum increase of a function. So when I am saying gradient, I am talking about gradient ascent, which gives me a direction in the maximum increase of a function. So if I talk about gradient descent, definitely we all will be able to understand. It gives me a direction where my function will be minimum. So when I talk about gradient descent, I am talking about a direction where my function is going to attain a minimum value. To understand this, I just would like to quote one example. If you can see here, some mountain is appearing on the screen. So imagine a blindfolded man who wants to climb to the top of a hill. Now, when man would like to climb the top of the hill, again, man would like to take a fewer steps along with the possible way and then try to come to the top of the hill. He might start climbing the hill by taking big steps in the steepest direction, because if person has to reach to the hill quickly, so we take the steepest direction, which he can do as long as he is not close to the top. I mean to say, person can take a bigger steps through the steepest direction and try to reach to the top as early as possible. But when person is taking a longer step, it might have happened if the person will not continue with the same, or person will continue with the same pace, person may overjump the top of the hill and will reach to the other side of hill. So what person has to do? As long as person is not nearer to the top of the hill, person is allowed to take a bigger step. But as soon as person will reach to the closer to the top of the hill, person will start taking the smaller step to avoid the overshooting. So this process, mathematically, we can describe using the gradient. Instead of climbing up a hill, if we need to come down to the bottom of a hill, then this will be related to gradient descent. Now, in data science context, a gradient simply measures the change in the error with respect to all weights. Higher the gradient, faster the model can adapt.
Madam, you are mute. Madam, you are mute. Please unmute yourself.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, some technicality issue was there. Okay. Coming back to this. So before I go to the gradient descent algorithm terminology, or maybe talking much about the application part, let's first understand some terminology of the data science, which probably makes my understanding more easier. So what is the aim of any data science model is? The aim of any data science model is to minimize the cost function. So when I say to minimize the cost function, how this cost function is going to occur? So what data science model does for the given set of inputs and their outputs, data science model tries to make some predictions for a new set of inputs. So through the model that given input and output will pass through, we will have some kind of observation for them. And if any prediction is needed based on this observation, we are going to predict for new input. It may happen when I predict for a new input, I may be getting an actual output or I may be getting an approximate output. If I am getting an approximate output, definitely I will be getting an error. Or whatever difference I am getting between the actual output and predicted output, I will be naming here it as an error. Fine. So maybe while applying the model, we might come across the error. And definitely when I come across an error, my target is always going to minimize the error, because the word itself says we need to minimize the error. So this particular terminology gives me the idea about loss function and cost function. So loss function computes the error in a single training of the model, and the cost function is the average of loss function across all the trainings of the model. So one run, whatever the error we are getting, that we will be calling as a loss function. And in all run, whatever the average of loss function we are getting, that we are going to consider as a cost function. This loss and cost function evaluates the performance of our algorithm, as they are related to the error, and always error has to be minimized. These two will decide the performance of our algorithm. A cost function basically tells us how good our model is at making the predictions. And the goal of any algorithm, as I said earlier, is definitely to minimize the cost function. And this is where my gradient steepest descent algorithm is applicable. So before I come to this algorithm, I just want to understand one real world problem, and I see how in terminology of data science I can relate that problem. But that problem I would like to understand through this video. So let's go through the video, or let's see the video first. Then we try to understand what is happening in the video. It's a request to all, please observe the video properly. Okay.
Okay.
try to imagine a situation based on whatever the pictures appearing in front of you. The intuitive we need to be. Fine. What I observed here, what did I observe in the video? One second. I would like to play the video again. Okay. See, I just understand in this way. A person is maybe at the top of the hill and is trying to come down. So when person is trying to come down, there are extreme conditions. In the sense, it's a heavy fog and visibility is low. Due to this heavy fog, the person will not be able to figure out the path to come down to the mountain. So maybe person has to utilize some local information and then try to find out by which path person can come to downstairs little easily. When I'm saying local information, I mean to say that maybe person has to see the environment around. Person might have a different possible ways to come down. If you would have seen in the video, three directions we have shown to come down. So person has to take a proper judgment. What is the steepness of the hill? Whether coming down through any of this way is going to be safe for a person or not. So all these things, person need to have the intuition, and based on the intuition, person need to decide. Maybe out of this three way, person is deciding this particular way and then trying to come down. So, again visualize it. See, person is thinking how it person can go down, the local information around the person. Three paths are available. The many more other paths are there, but we have not shown it here. So maybe the guess is coming correct. So a person is smiling and now thinking another three paths, how I need to move ahead. Then again chosen a correct path and again smiling for the choosing the correct path. Again taken a third path and then try to come down. Okay, how am I going to analog this with my gradient descent algorithm? Here, person we can consider as an algorithm. So my person is an algorithm. Whatever available paths you based on local information could be the sequence of parameters that my algorithm is going to explore. Now I just want to add a little spice to this. Suppose man is having an instrument to measure the steepness of the hill. Now, as he has an instrument to measure the steepness of the hill, person would like to take the advantage of this instrument, and then person can try to come down easily. But now, again, there is a problem. Either that instrument is taking lots of time to give the measurement, or probably instrument is not working. So in this case, the difficulty level of the algorithm is increasing. So in this context, the steepness of the hill we represent as a slope of the error surface. The instrument, what person has to measure the steepness, can be taken as a differentiation, and the direction he chose to travel is the gradient of that error function at that particular point. And whatever time person has taken in one move, that we can call as a epoch or a learning rate of the algorithm. So this is the way, probably this real world problem, we will be modeling, and then with the possible tools, we are going to analyze this modeling. And then whatever way the result is supposed to be predicted, we will be able to predict the result. Now, let's take up one more example where we want to train the algorithm with gradient descent to minimize the cost function. So here what I did, I have taken a cost function as Z, and that cost function is depending upon two parameters, X and Y, which are not shown in the diagram, but the usual notation what we know, I try to consider the similar one. So my cost function is Z, it is depending upon X and Y. This parameter X and Y, I have plotted horizontally, or we have plotted, or we have considered horizontally, and the cost function is taken on a vertical axis. So what we would like to do here, see, I just want to minimize this cost function. My gradient descent is going to be this convex function. When I am saying I want to minimize the cost function, definitely we would like to find out the value of X and Y, which will give me the minimum value of this Z. But how am I going to go about it? So I need to initialize my X and Y. So when I initialize my X and Y, maybe for data science, we try to be somewhere here by initializing X and Y at the point A. And I start with the point A, and then I try to minimize my cost, in the sense I'm trying to reach to this red point, which right now I'm identifying as a point of minima for the cost function. So probably now I need to start my journey from A and I need to reach to B by taking some appropriate steps. So this is where I'm going to get my descent algorithm, gradient descent algorithm, or gradient descent tells me how I need to take a step. Now, whatever step we are taking here, that we are identifying, or that we are calling as learning rate. So now my interest is, what will be our learning rate? How can I decide the step so that comfortably and as per the need, I can come to my minima? So when we talk about this particular learning rate, there is no fixed criteria how to consider the learning rate. One can start with a smaller learning rate, or one can start with the big learning rate. But one has to be very careful while choosing the learning rate. What happens if I take a big learning rate, that value is going to be bigger, then it may happen that I will be only bounce back and forth within this convex region, and I may not be able to reach to the minima. If in case I take a smaller learning rate or smaller epoch, then coming to this very small step, coming to this minima will take lots of time and it becomes time consuming. As I said, there is no fixed criteria to decide the learning rate. It's going to be only on trial and error basis. But of course, one remedy is there for us. What we can do, we can have the plot, and then graphically we can analyze what learning rate should be considered. Maybe number of iterations we plot on the x-axis, and the optimum value of the cost function, what we obtain at each iteration, can be plotted on the y-axis. So when I consider this plot, three different possibilities I have considered here. So if I talk about the leftmost curve, if you see the leftmost curve, maybe with the number of iterations, the cost function has started decreasing. But after some time, it has become steady, stagnant. It's not changing. So if I am coming to the minima, which probably we think towards the infinity of the x-axis for imagination, then definitely we are not going to get it. So this particular case is considered as a big learning rate or a high learning rate, and this is not advisable. But in case if I take this learning rate or I reduce it and I take it very small, then what will happen? Look at this part. My function value is decreasing, but it is decreasing very slowly. Of course, this learning rate can be considered, but it will take more iteration to reach to the minimization. So preferably we try to find out, can we improve this learning rate little bit so that we can little faster reach to the minimization? See the third one, the middle one. If I see the middle curve, slowly, gradually, my function is reducing, but maybe reducing with a little faster rate, and then trying and then coming to the minima with less number of steps. Fine. So maybe I have to choose between these two learning rate, then this learning rate is going to be preferable over this. So this is the way one has to take a call. What will be a learning rate we will consider so that model can give me the prediction as per my expectation, as per real world expectation. What I have spoken to you, mathematically, it's going to be a very, very simple formula. This is what the gradient descent algorithm use the equation, where instead of x and y, theta is my, you may say, parameter or new position of a parameter. Theta zero is the current or a older position of a parameter. Negative sign will see how it is coming. Alpha we call as an epoch or a learning rate. This j is a cost which is depending upon the parameter theta. As we are trying to minimize this particular cost, so I need to differentiate this, because if you consider the analogy of a calculus, we all know how to find the minimum and maximum value of a given function. So this gradient will give me the rate of change of the cost function. The negative sign will give me the descent. So the gradient descent algorithm is using this simple formula, and this formula we derived with the, or this formula is nothing but the Taylor series for the multi variables. So this Taylor series we have approximated for two terms, and that gives me my gradient descent algorithm's formula. So probably if I know how I need to talk about the learning rate, how I need to find the differentiation or rate of change of cost function, I might be able to address my error in an easier way. Again, a small video to visualize how the gradient descent is giving us a different possibility. Would like to play this video. Please listen it carefully. Is it audible?
No, madam.
Okay. It's not
played. As his name suggests, such a process follows a path through state space by always taking the direction in which the energy landscape descends fastest. So two balls indicate two gradient flow paths, beginning at different starting points and ending up in different local minima.
So mathematically, probably before we talk about the minima, we might have to explore the local minima as well as global minima. So not now understanding this part, would like to go to a next and last part of this presentation, which is the single value decomposition. These are going to be two different concepts. One is a gradient descent algorithm. Another one is going to be singular value decomposition. Maybe modeling use either of this algorithm, or maybe it is a hybrid model, then it might be using more than one concept as well. Why I need to know about this singular value decomposition? Where is it occurring? How it is going to help me in my data science model? So we all are knowing, or we might have experienced it also. Nowadays, when we open Netflix, they give us some recommendation for the movies. If I open Google, some window pop up and tell me, this is for you. If I visit my YouTube, again, some window will pop up and say, this is for you. How this recommending system is working, how this recommendation is coming to us, the answer for all this will be given through this single value decomposition. Of course, in that depth, we will not be discussing, but we will understand for the recommending, how the recommending system is going to work. So suppose I consider the data of Netflix where users have seen some movies. So what I'm trying to do, this data I will represent in terms of array, where the row of the array will indicate my users and the column of the array is taken as a movies, and entries or elements of this arrays is the rate what users have given after seeing the movie. Now, when I have this data, lots of analysis needed, or I can analyze this data in all dimension and I can predict whatever output or whatever prediction is required out of that. It might have happened. The two movies might have got the same rating. So it tells me what is the nature of this movie, or maybe movie belonging to the same category. It might have happened. Two users might have given the same rating. It says both the users will have a similar kind of liking. It may happen.
Thoda sa pitch badha dijiye. There is a request coming. Voice is
okay. Okay. So if it may happen when I add up this one and two rows, then I will be getting my third row. So some mathematical observation might be involved there. So one need to be very intuitive. And this intuition, I personally feel when I know mathematics, I know some of my real life operations, then this intuition comes very easily. It might have happened if user has not seen the movie and we want to predict if in case user will see the movie, what will be his or her rating for that particular movie? So all these things can be addressed through this data science and all this technology where we are going to use this SVD. But it is not going to be that easy the way I am explaining and we are trying to understand here. It's very complicated process. Either you need to have you have to decide first of all, whether you need a prediction for the movie or you need the prediction for a user. What I want to say here, probably I need to categorize my data, and that categorization can be based on the classification of a movie, or this categorization can be based on the nature of the users. And once I categorize my data based on what I need to predict, do I need a prediction for movie or users? Then I need to take the help of SVD, and then SVD will help me to get the prediction for whatever category I have considered. So this is what the utility of SVD I have understood. And that is why when we are analyzing a data, this gradient descent algorithm, SVD, what mathematics behind there is that we can use as a tool, and then we can answer whatever is expected out of that model. What are the application or other application of this SVD? As I said, SVD deals with the large data sets. This is really the basis for Google to determine which pages to rank first, Amazon to determine which products they think you are going to buy, Netflix to build a profile of what movie taste you have, or this could be used to build facial recognition software in genetic markers that are characteristic of healthy virus, sick patients, and the list goes on and on. So due to the ample applications, SVD attracted tons of money and the big brand. SVD is the unsupervised machine learning algorithm, and it is second most important algorithm after FFT. This is the basic computation for your PCA. This forms a basis for my machine learning. SVD allows you to take the training data from your past experience and essentially build a model and extrapolate what other situation would look like. So SVD is a very is a way of extracting the most important features, sometimes considered in data science terminology is dominance features. So SVD is a very, very, very simple matrix decomposition. And it always exists for a matrix, irrespective whether the matrix is going to be a square matrix or a rectangle matrix. I use the word irrespective of the dimension of a matrix purposely because we know about the eigen decomposition. With the help of eigenvalue and vector, we can diagonalize a matrix. So SVD, but when we talk about the diagonalization, I have a restriction. My matrix should be square. Even if I have a square matrix, not necessarily that matrix is going to be a diagonalizable. So when I take the help of eigen decomposition, I might be failing to decompose a matrix into the small parts, but SVD is allowing me to do that. So SVD doesn't depend on the depend upon the structure of a matrix. SVD can be taken as a generalization of eigen decomposition. Mind well, I am using that, or I'm saying that this is a generalized decomposition method for a matrix. SVD is particularly used when we have given a big data. What I mean by big data? This data is going to be more in volume. And we fail to plot this data graphically. So we fail to find the relation between the considered data graphically. So suppose we have a data matrix A made up of bunch of column vectors, x1, x2, and xn. Each column of a matrix represents some big measurement. If this measurement is considered with respect to the time, then that sequence of measurement we call as a snapshot. It may happen when I'm considering this big data, I have two different situations. My n can be more than m, or my m can be more than n, or very, very large, I mean to say. So let's take an example, how this rows will be more than the columns. So to understand this, I just consider the temperature of the weather station on a planet Earth on day one. Means my first column is giving me the temperature at all weather stations in day one. And all weather station, when I'm saying whatsoever weather station existing on the Earth, the globally I'm talking about. Fine. The day two temperature we have stored in X2, day three temperature we are storing in day three. So definitely the number of whatever the weather station I have, it's going to be very, very large globally when we are talking about. So probably I store all this temperature for 10 days and then I would like to analyze the data and then I would like to see what will be the future weather prediction. Another example, if I take whatever the recent analysis of COVID we are getting, that could be done through SVD. Of course, you will have a COVID case study on a very last day. So you will understand how that COVID data is related to this particular big data in volume. So if I consider the first column or X1 vector, number of COVID patients in all districts of India. I don't remember how many districts I have in a country, but at least I can imagine I might have 400, 500 districts. So this column vector is consisting of the COVID patient information for a 400, 500 districts in a day one. When I come to X2, the same 400, 500 districts information for day two is stored in this second vector. Likewise, third day is stored in third vector, and again we can collect the data for a 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, and we analyze how the patients are going to increase or decrease in the future. Fine. This are the examples where we discuss my N is going to be very, very big than M. But if, is it possible that my M could also be a bigger than, very, very big than N? Yes, of course, that is also possible. I pick up the example of a stock market. In the stock market, we have ample numbers of stock, but I choose only 10 stocks and I try to track this 10 stocks for their rate on every second, probably for 365 days. Imagine, in an hour we have a 60 seconds, in a day we have a 24 hours, and this days we will be continuing till 365. So when this 10 stocks I'm tracking for 365 days on a second basis, then definitely the column wise, this matrix is going to be very, very large. Maybe people can reduce the number of monitoring, the number of days for the monitoring, but this is just hypothetical example I have taken. So we have both the possibilities. Anyway, the data we are going to represent in terms of a matrix, and then we are going to see how we are going to predict the dominant feature of this particular data. So as I said earlier, my SVD is nothing, but it's a way of rewriting the matrix as a product of three new matrices. These three new matrices are going to be very, very simple compared to one linear transformation A, or compared to this matrix A. So what am I trying to do? The matrix I am going to divide or split into three smaller matrices, and then I'm going to analyze the data available in this three smaller matrices. Geometrically, if I would like to see this, so this linear transformation, I am converting into three different transformation, which gives me rotation, stretching, as well as rotation or reflection. So this is what mathematically we try to analyze SVD. When I'm saying this three decomposition I'm getting, of course, this three decomposition are also going to be a spatial type. This U matrix is comparatively going to be a larger matrix. Sigma is going to be a diagonal matrix, and V matrix is going to be a little smaller in size than U. U and V will have a spatial property. U and V are always going to be a unitary matrix. And being a unitary matrix, if I need to invert, I can invert them very easily. Being a unitary matrix, their vectors are always going to be orthogonal to each other. Even this diagonal matrix sigma will also have a specific feature. What I mean by specific feature? This diagonal elements are considered as eigenvalues of A transpose A, and A transpose A eigenvalues are always going to be real and positive, and we are going to name them as a singular values. So when I try to form the diagonal matrix with the help of singular values, one particular pattern we follow, the biggest singular value will be placed at the first place. The smaller than that will be placed at the second order. So the descending order, we will be considering the singular values. And when I try to see this product in terms of mathematics, it will be resulting into a small, small matrices, sum of small matrices. Why I am emphasizing on the word small matrices? Because the size of A is too big. So when we need to store this matrix, we need lots of space. But when I have to store a comparatively very small matrix, I need the less storage. Another thing, for a large matrix, I need more computational time while For a smaller matrix, my computation time is also going to reduce. So what is expected? Whatever data I have collected, whatever way I have analyzed, if I have to predict some particular features, then depending upon the number of features, I can cut short my decomposition. I mean to say, if we want to predict the three dominant feature, then we can only consider diagonal matrix, 3x3 diagonal matrix, by keeping first three dominant singular values, and then we can have the prediction about whatever features we would like to predict. I have a liberty here to increase the diagonal elements and decrease the diagonal elements. I keep in mind, I can cut short my rest of the diagonal elements, because magnitude wise, this diagonal elements are going to be smaller comparative to the earlier one. So maybe whatever feature are given by those diagonal elements will not play that dominant role compared to this earlier features. And that is why, depending upon what, let's say if I take a COVID case, so I am only interested to know how many positive patients are there, what is the death rate, and how many are surviving, and how many are negative. So if I want to only analyze these three things, then through this, after considering the decomposition, I can consider the matrix, diagonal matrix, in a smaller dimension, and then I can predict the things. Fine. This is what the mathematical structure of SVD. But when, instead of calculating manually, we need to calculate it through the software, it's a single word work. Just I give the command SVD and my calculation done. But at least we should be familiar what mathematics was behind this particular calculation, SVD. So this is what my intention was, to explain you SVD little bit mathematically. Of course, what software does, how it will cut short the matrix, that animation we can observe through this video, or through this animation we can observe it. A large data is available, slowly, slowly data is getting cut, and it will reduce to the diagonal one. See, SVD was discovered in 19th century, but this algorithm was developed in 1970s. So years ago, the SVD has been explored. So it's not that SVD is somewhat new technique that we have invented for data science. This is all from my side. I hope you all must have enjoyed today's session. Thank you everyone for patiently hearing. Over to you, host. Ayushi, are you there?
Neeta ma'am, can you share your mail since the no question has come?
Okay, during the, okay, fine. Any question answer, any question is there, we are ready to take. Or if you feel, you can mail me the question. This is my mail ID. Okay. Thank you, Vaibhav sir. Thank you, everyone. Over to you, host. I stop my screen sharing.
Vaibhav sir, you are mute. Please unmute yourself.
Thank you, madam, for giving session. Now, madam, you already shared your email ID. So, participant can directly ask the questions to ma'am, then she will reply. So now, I request Niket sir for briefing us about quiz. Niket sir.
Nitesh sir, you are mute. Unmute yourself first, please. Yeah.
Thank you, Vaibhav sir. And good afternoon, all the teachers and all the participants. So I will be giving you the demonstration to the quiz using the YAKSH platform. So YAKSH platform is used in the IITs, IIT Bombay, especially for conducting the online exam. So we are also have implemented the same platform, right? So I'll tell you to how to give attempt the quiz through that platform.
Niket sir, can you repeat what you said, please? Aram sir, no problem, sir.
Yes, sir. See the YAKSH online examination platform. This YAKSH online examination platform is used by IIT Bombay and some corporate companies which are coming for the IIT Bombay. So they are specially using it to conduct their online examination. So they are not depending upon any other online platforms, right? They are having their own platform. So we, for our college, we have also implemented the same platform. So we will be conducting today's quiz using that platform. So I will be giving you the demonstration how to attempt the quiz, and there is one document also which I have created. So at the end of the presentation, you will get the document also. So if something is missed out, you can refer to that document and you can see how to attempt the quiz, right? So so I will start with the demonstration, right? So for the demonstration, I will share my screen. Right. So for this, this is the website, or this is the link. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
This is the screen. This is the IP address. So this IP address, you have to click on this IP address. So once you click on this IP address, I will just go to the web portal and I will show you the live demonstration. So for this, yes. So this is the IP address. This is the IP address which I have typed. Right, so this is the login for this. Now you are the new user. So for new user, you have to see this is a login ID, username and password. So for the new user, you have to click on this option, new user sign up, right? So new user sign up, and this Google and this Facebook, these options will not work in our case, right? So only new user sign up, you have to go and you have to click on the new user sign up, right? So and once you click on this new user sign up, you will get one window. So this is the window. So here you have to just give a name, that is a username, right? So I'm just giving student 5. So any username you can want, if you want, you can give, you give any username, you just give any username, you give your email address, right? So give your email address here. And after giving the email address, you have to give a password that you have to set, and then confirm the password. Now it is very important that because next time you have to remember your user ID and password, because next time when you will log in through the user ID and password. You will not be able to log in through the email ID, because this feature, forget password, is not activated, right? So, and you cannot use this Gmail and Facebook login. So you have to always remember your username and password, which you are going to set here. So you have to write down your user ID and you have to write down your password, which we have set, right? So this is two very important steps. So after doing this, you have to just type your name, and then you have to type, and then roll number. So in this, see, this roll number field, this field is mandatory. So if you are not having roll number, you can just type any number, right? So if you are not having roll number, you can just put any number, because this field cannot be left blank. So you can type any number here, and after typing any number, you have to type the institute, whatever institute and department and the position, and the time is by default Asia Kolkata. So you have to just click on the register. Right. So this is what is the registration process. So in this, is this much clear? If anyone is having doubt in the registration process, you can ask me in the chat, or you can say if anything, anyone is having in the process of registration, you can ask me now. Okay. So I think there are so no questions are there. So I think registration. People have understood.
There is a question is coming, Niket, place.
Yes, sir. Place is by default Asia Kolkata is selected. You don't have to change anything. Just Asia Kolkata, by default, it is going to be there, because it is the setting from IIT Bombay, so you don't do anything. Just you click on register. Just you fill these fields, and after this, don't do anything. Just let it be Asia Kolkata, and you click on register. That is what.
Niket, can you share the URL into the chat box as well? copy
yes, sir, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'll just do that. This is the URL in the chat box. So if you want some time for 5 minutes, I give you time for 5 minutes. You do the registration, and in the time, in the process of registration, if you have any doubt, you can ask. So if you want to try, you can try registration now, because it will hardly take 2 minutes to register. So you can do the registration. It is simple process. So once you are done with the registration, you can I will continue with my demonstration. If you have any doubt, you can put it in the chat box. I will continue. So once you have done the registration, I will log in. So I am having one question is there. Yes. So Nitin sir has registered. Very good, Nitin sir. You have registered. There is no problem faced by you in registration. Now after the registration and Nitin sir is done, now what we will do, I will just log in because I have already registered. So I will log in with the student ID. So I will just log in with the student ID, which is the this is the student ID, which is demonstration I have created for demonstration. So once you log in, now after you log in, so you will get this page. There are so many courses. So in, because you are a new user, so only Yaksh demo quiz, only this course will be visible, and these courses will not be visible, because this is the only this course will be visible for you. So what you have to do, you have to just click on this and you have to type this code MD01. So this is M stands for mathematics, MD stands for data science, and 01 is the code. So MD01. Don't have to attempt any of this quiz. You have to just type MD0 and you have to click on this search.
Yes, Niket, go slow, a bit slow. Okay. There is no problem. There is no time constraint. You can take okay. your time, please.
Okay. So what after login, as I told, you will get this window. In this window, you will not get so many courses, but only demo course is going to be there. So this is a demo course, and you will not get any of these courses. So once you get this window after login, so in this window, you have to type this code. I'll just type this code. It is MD01 in the chat box also. So MD01. So this is the code. M stands for mathematics, D stands for data science, and this is 01. So this is the code. You have to just copy this code, or you can type this code, and you can just put it here. Now this code is the actual quiz code. This actual quiz code, this is only given to the candidate who has to appear for the quiz, and it is not given, it is not displayed anywhere. So you have to just type this code, which is specifically set for this quiz only, right? So you have to type this code and you have to search, right? So you, when you will search, you will find this code. This is this title is coming, that is calculus for data science by Dr. Neetajan. So you will refer to the session. Today's session was So today's session is by Dr. Neeta Jain. When you click on these details, you will find that this is calculus. And see, you can see here, this examination time is from 12:30 p.m. and this exam time is still 8 p.m. today, right? So during this duration from 12:30 to 8 p.m., you can attempt this quiz. So this is the time, this is the window. But after 8 p.m., if you will click on this link, then this will be deactivated. This will be deactivated, and it will come like this. It will be coming like this. I'll just show you the screen. It will come like this. I'll show another screen. This is what will appear. When you will, after the time, before or after the time, is the screen visible? Right. So before 12:30 or after 8 p.m. Before 12:30, after 8 p.m., it will come as enrollment close, right? Because that is the window for doing the enrollment and giving the exam, right? So this will come like enrollment close. But now the time is, I think the time is 12:37. So that is why it is coming. Now the time is around 12:37. So that is why this enroll button has enabled. Otherwise, yahan pe enrollment disable karke option mein aata. Okay, sir. Sir, is this much clear? What we have done? This when you will search, And after searching this, okay, sir. Sir, what you have to do that you have when see once you go to this yaksh, you have to just type MD01. Just type MD01 and you click on the search. And when you click on the search, you will get this option. And you click on these details. Yes, sir. I am having this document. I will share this document after the presentation. I will share this document. So, till this step, everyone has done till this step. Okay, URL once again. I will share the URL again. I will do this one thing. I will just send this document.
You can send the document to me. I will share it with the group.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'll just do that. I'll just send the document.
Yes, sir. For the ease of all participants, we can share speaker's email ID as well as the feedback registration link as well as this PDF document of yours.
Okay, sir. I'll just send this document. Right, so we are in this, so we have all of, everyone has done, everyone has understood till this step. Now, once we search the code, course code, and we click on search, we will get this. So in the details, we can check about the course. And see, this is just the indication that our quiz will start from 12:30 p.m. and this is the date. So from this date and this time, our quiz is going to start. And it will end on this time, right? So, so if you will attend the quiz after 8 p.m., so this will be disabled. This enroll button will not be there. This button will become disabled. So you have to. This is a time window. In which time window you have to attempt the quiz. So this is what is set. Right? So after you have done till this step, what you have to do? You have to click on this enroll button, right? Because you are enrolling for this quiz. So you just click on this enroll button, and after you click on this enroll button, you will see that you get this message that enroll in calculus for data science by Dr. Nitha Jain. Right, this is coming. Right, so you have successfully enrolled for this course. This green bar means that you have successfully enrolled for this course. Right, till this much is clear. Yes, Gunjan Kumar, you have raised your hand. Yes, Gunjan, please ask what you have to ask. Yes, sir.
Can you please again share the URL link for the participants who were disconnected?
You are okay. Okay, I'll again share that. Just 1 minute. I'll again share that. So this is the link again. You can enroll.
Sir, H is not.
H is missing.
HTTP
updates. Okay, sir. One minute, sir. I've shared this file in the chat. So if you can download this file. With everyone, I have shared this file. So you can see, refer to this file. I'll just type this URL again. So, right. So you have to just go to this URL. And after going to the URL, you have to register. So after going to the URL, you have to register. And after registering, you have to do? Just I'm going to the home page. Yeah. I have to click on this enroll. So see, when this is MD01, and when you search it, I have already enrolled, so that is why this button is coming. Start button is coming. Right? Have you done till this step? till this step, and then you are done till this step, and tell me, then I will go ahead.
Okay, Niket, you can go ahead further.
Okay. Yes, this is the course code. Everything is there in the document, right? So you can refer to the document also. Now, enrollment, after enrolling, you can see the details. You will see the same details are there. The exam will start from 12:30 p.m. and the exam will end at 8 p.m. Right? So this is the window. So after doing this, you have to click on the start button, because now you have enrolled for the quiz. Yes, let it be. If it is asking for the Python programming, see, by default we have to see that is a default option, so that will not have any issues. So if the Python is coming, there is no issue. It will accept. No issue with the Python. I'll just start. When I will click on this start, see, again this window will come, calculus for data science, right? So again. Right, so you have to click on again start. Now you have to remember that this is the quiz from, so from this window, when you will click on this start, your quiz will start from this window, right? So after this, your quiz will start, and you have to remember that there is only one attempt, right? So when you submit the quiz, you will not be able to resubmit. So have you reached till this step? Just reached till this step, and if you have reached till this step, just type done. In the chat box, just type done, so that I will come to know that you have done till this step. Yes, we still this step. Okay, so Mahesh Kumar sir has done. Okay, so this step. And Kumar sir has also done till this step. Okay, so Chandra sir has also done. So right, so the people have done the registration. They have searched the quiz. And they have searched the quiz.
Niket sir, unmute yourself.
I am not able to unmute. Okay, yes, now I know. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Right. So now what is this? Now this is the timing of the quiz, and this is the instruction. So you can read this instruction, and after reading this instruction, you click on start button. Right? Start button. See here, welcome student is coming, right? Because I am using a demo ID. So that is the otherwise in place of student, your name will come. What you have put in the registration process, right? So you're welcome. Your name will come, right? For programming quiz. Now you have to start the quiz. Now when you will click on the start quiz. Yes, how to do the final submission? Just wait, sir. I am just telling. Click on the start quiz. Now see here, you will get the questions. Now see here, you will see that there is a quit exam button, right? So now you will see that these are the five questions are there. So you have to read the question, and you have to click on whatever option you think is right. So for example, if you think that this is right, then you have to click and then submit button. When you submit this button, this will become green because your question is attempted. This will become green, right? Similarly, if you are doing a second question and you are thinking the second question is very tough, and you want to come back for reading this question later on, so you can go to the third question. So you can click on this third question, and whatever is option is right, you can click on this option. Whatever option you think is right, you click on this option and you submit that answer, right? Similarly, you can go to the third question. You can come back. And you can submit the answer. Like this, you attempt all the quiz, whatever you think is right, you attempt the answers. And then you can again come back to this option, and you can try the answer. Now, if you think that for question number 4, by mistake, you have selected a wrong option, so you can again click on this and you can resubmit that option. So now you can again come back to the 4 and you will see that your option is same. Right? So in this way, see, you are having about 3 hours to solve this 5 questions. So once this timer starts, if you will not submit the quiz even after 3 hours or this timer, the quiz will be auto submit, right? So it will auto submit, right? So this is this time is enough for solving 5 questions. So this is the time, right? So this is the timer and this is the finish button. Now see one thing when you are solving this quiz from the mobile platform. So in the mobile platform, I will just share this screen again. In the mobile platform, this option is not coming because most of the time, just share the screen again. Open the quiz in the mobile platform, but I am not getting any this timer button and quit exam button here, right? So for this, what you have to do, you have to click on this menu here. Yeah, menu, you have to click, then this will be displayed, right? So most of the time when the candidate, when the participant is solving the quiz, they confused that there is no quit button and timer thing here. So you have to click here, then the timer will come, right? So right. So now once you have attempted the questions, you can review the questions. See, in the roll number section, you can put any number. If you want to put, you can put your PAN number also. If you want to put, you can put your Aadhaar number also. If you want to put, you can put any number. But that field cannot be left blank, right? So in the process of the registration, you can put any number. Right, you can put your Aadhaar number, you can put your PAN number, or if you want to put a random number 123, you can put that also. But that field cannot be left blank, right? So you have to just put a number because that is a validation for that field. Yes. Now what happened? That now you can still have time. If you want to change the option, you can review the question. You can change the option, and after you are when you are confident that you have attempted all the questions properly, right? Because when you finish the exam and you submit the quiz, you cannot again start the quiz. And if the time is up and you finished and you fail to submit the quiz, even if you have attempted half of the question, the quiz will be auto submit, right? So this is, you have to be careful about the timer. So since it is the first day, that's why we have given enough time to solve this quiz, right? So once you are done with this, then you have to finish. Then you have to click on this finish exam. So you click on this finish exam, and after you finish exam, you have to, your current answer is saved, and then you have to click on yes. Right. So if you want to still want to go back, you can click on no. You will again go back to the previous page. Otherwise, if you are done, you have to click on yes. And once you click on yes, your quiz has been submitted. Now, when you click on this next option, you will again come back to this page. And when you will click on the start again, your quiz will not start. Again, you will be come back to this page only. Your quiz will not start because we have set only one attempt in the settings. Right. So this quiz is only for one attempt. So that carefully attempt all the questions, and then you have to click on the submit, because this is not going to start. So your answer is recorded and it is saved in the server. So this is how you have to attempt the quiz. Yes, sir. So one query is there. Yes, if you get disconnected, you can again restart the quiz, because agar aapne submit उतने ही क्वेश्चंस जितने आपने अटेम्प्ट किए रहेंगे, उतने क्वेश्चंस जो मार्क रहेंगे, आप फिर से लॉगिन करके उसी स्टेटस के आगे से सॉल्व करना चालू कर सकते हैं। See, the result will not be shared with the student. The result will be the result is in the server. So that will be shared with the faculty who has prepared the quiz. Only he can share the result with the students. After submitting the quiz, sir, after submitting the quiz, when you have submitted, then you can log out. Then you can click on this and then you can log out, because that is only one attempt. So then you can log out, your quiz is submitted.
Madam, But you remember your login ID and password for the next
week? Yes, sir. That is very important, sir. That is important point which sir has said, that you have to write down your password and username, because that is very crucial. You write down, don't forget user ID and password.
Okay, Nikhil sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, Vaibhav sir. Thank you for briefing on quiz. Now we are at the end of this session, and I, Vaibhav Matne, assistant professor from Department of Mechanical Engineering, take this opportunity to thank Nita Jain madam for giving such a wonderful session on calculus for data science. Definitely this will create interest among students about calculus, and participant must have understood the importance of calculus in the field of data science. So once again, I would like to thank Nita Jain ma'am for sparing valuable time and being a part of this workshop. Thank you. Now there is an important announcement for participants. So second session will start at 3 p.m. All the participants are requested to join. And with this, I stop here. Stay home, stay safe.
All the participants are requested to turn on their camera for a quick snapshot. Thank you, everyone.
The afternoon session link has been shared in the group. It is made. It will be mailed also. So please, all of you, join at 3 o'clock for the afternoon session on hands-on for R programming. Thank you.
So we can end the meeting. Shall I end the meeting?
Yes, sir. You can end the meeting.